So I used to do this music business podcast for a lot of years. We were one of the first music business tech discussion podcasts, and definitely the only one in the punk indie sphere when we started in 2014. I did this with my co-host Zack Zarrillo, who's managed bands like Brand New, Knuckle Puck, and now works with artists like Cavetown, Chloe Moriondo, and Kevin Devine. He has a label through Electro and Warner Music Group and does a ton of cool things, and most of all, he really knows his shit. We decided to do a reunion episode of our podcast where we talked like we used to talk. While I think the whole podcast really hit on a lot of things, and you should definitely go to the description and follow the link and listen to it all, we had a particularly interesting talk that I'm going to play after this that artists should hear part of the conversation of. I thought this was particularly important for the musicians who pay attention to my channel to hear, as it talks about how you build YouTube and how you should see building a fan base. So what you're about to hear is a portion of our conversation on how to use YouTube right and build a fan base slowly. If you enjoyed what we talked about, you can listen to the full podcast by following the links in the description.
But speaking of YouTube, I think one of the cool things you and I should talk about, because I talk about your bands on my YouTube channel because they do such cool things, is you have two artists that particularly do amazing things on YouTube. I wanted to ask you to talk about what you see as the YouTube landscape these days and how your artists connect on there, because one, Cavetown and Chloe do YouTube better than most any artist. And two, I never think musicians put enough of an emphasis on YouTube, and they do it well and are really rewarded for it because their numbers are insane out there.
Yeah, I never took YouTube seriously as a platform for my artists that I managed before I started working with Robin, who's Cavetown. First of all, I will say I am not a big YouTube person myself. I subscribe to a bunch of channels. I watch a few creators regularly and pretty much nothing else. So like I was a huge fan of like when Casey Neistat was in the heyday of his vlog days. That really inspired me and I loved that. I subscribe to a bunch of tech YouTubers like MKBHD. And then I watch one series from The Ringer, which is a sports publication called NBA Desktop, which is one of my favorite things on the internet. But otherwise, I really don't like engage with YouTube that much other than watching. I mean, honestly, the most YouTube I watch is probably of like my artists when they're putting out new stuff. So I'm kind of like a bad person for that. And that's why I think it was a blind spot for me where like Grace, my wife, like she watches, I don't know, she might watch an hour of YouTube stuff a day, you know, or more.
I'm about that, if not more.
Yeah. And as I started to work with Robin about 2.5 years ago now, like it became more and more clear that like YouTube is just TV for younger people, right? And that's a very known thing. It's not like me saying that as a surprise. That is considered to be like an industry standard thing that people know now. But it was not something I really thought much about because my artists, like a lot of like the more like punk or alternative artists I worked with, and some still do work with, they were not creating content, right? Like they're my age, they're anywhere from 20 now 7 to whatever 30 something, and they did not grow up with like a phone in their hand, like an iPhone in their hand, like Robin or Chloe did. And I think because of that, like how they create stuff is very different. So when I found Robin, his music was only on YouTube and Spotify. Nothing was on DSPs.
So funny when you see that.
It was insane. I mean, really now when we think about how much he's grown in 2.5 years, it's pretty staggering that he did not exist on streaming services 2.5 years ago. And so Robin always considered himself an artist first, but, you know, to many people was a YouTuber, but he definitely did not want to be considered a YouTuber. And I did not want to manage a YouTuber, and I still don't. So that was very important to me. But I said, we really got to get all your stuff on DSPs. What was great about Robin was that, like, he really liked talking to his audience, and it was just him in his bedroom, and he didn't know he could step outside of his bedroom. And what we've done over the last 2.5 years is step him outside to tens of thousands of people outside of the bedroom. Unfortunately, as Robin has done that and has toured and has grown and has live life, like Robin actually makes a lot less YouTube content now in kind of like a vloggy sense, but we still treat his channel incredibly seriously. It is a loss leader for us. We spend a lot of money when he's on tour having really incredible videographers and sound people, et cetera, out to film and edit. And it's incredibly expensive for us. But
the stuff looks great, though, that you guys put out.
Yeah, we view it as a marketing tool that we think a lot of what I spend my time thinking about in like a big picture pie in the sky view as a manager right now is like, how can we invest in places where others can't? Robin is fortunate in that he owns the majority of his catalog, which means he sees the majority of his income own Spotify and Apple and et cetera. And a lot of his peers don't. Most people in the world don't. But that gives us a real head, a leg up in that if we decide to invest that money back into, talk about this like a business, if we decide to invest that money back into business, we can grow our business stronger than others can. And that's what we want. So we use his YouTube channel as a loss leader for us and as a marketing tool. And we want really high quality stuff mixed with personality things with Robin, whether that is him rating oat milk or him rating dogs or him doing a Q&A. And then we mix that with really incredible music videos and live performances, which I think now are kind of more valuable than ever when people are missing those things.
Yes.
So that's Robin. It's been a winding road. There was definitely a period where we really wanted Robin to be uploading one video a week. And then we gave up on that because it just blew up and we didn't think it was going to blow up. You know, we had him touring to his detriment pretty much for 2 years straight in music. And
oh, wow. I didn't realize that.
It was hard. I mean, he was really just the mistake. It's hard. It's not so much a mistake and no one really regrets it, but like we didn't think he was going to blow up how he did. So when we booked one tour, every tour we booked for a year should have been twice as big by the time that tour actually happened. So we had to keep kind of doing the next tour bigger because we didn't want to let it languish, you know? Now we're like kind of restructuring moving forward. But so yeah, like YouTube for him is still really important. We care deeply about that relationship with his audience, but we don't want YouTube. At some point, YouTube kind of became a chore for him. So he didn't want to do it if it wasn't like out of passion. So now we try to mix it up with what we put there. Chloe is a little different. Chloe is like a monster on YouTube.
Every time I go to show her to somebody, you know, it's funny. I was talking about both her and Chloe to Alan Douches' daughter, she's really becoming amazing at what she does. But it was like funny. It's like when I looked at the numbers on Saturday, I was like, oh my God, like this is so much bigger than the last time I looked.
Yeah. So Chloe just crossed 3 million subscribers. When I started working with her in August of 2018, I think she had just under 1 million. Which is crazy. She was 15 at the time, which is stupid. Now she has 3 million. And Chloe, unlike Robin, has actually never done the like talking to the camera about my life thing. She's only had one video like that ever. Chloe got really popular on YouTube by doing covers and her own songs.
But she talks a little bit before the song.
Yes, she does talk. Yes, and that's really crucial.
It's very compelling because you see...
You learn about her. Yeah,
Also, you know, we could all use the word authentic for a lot of things. Mm-hmm. It's so, like, more beyond what most artists are doing of connecting with somebody.
Yeah, it's very welcoming and revealing. And Chloe she's 17, and so I think she wants... That's what she wants out of the artist that she cares about, too, you know? Mm. And so, yeah, Chloe does that, and she's really good at it. Unlike Cavetown, she's never done those videos of, like, talking to the camera. I'm going to rate whatever, dogs or cats or stuff. But the algorithm has always loved her. And I mean, her videos, especially when she was doing covers, when I started working with her, would just explode. Like sometimes, you know, they'd get 100,000 plays in a night. And still now, because I mean, we have Chloe was in school all year. She just finished her senior year of school and we had her working really hard on music. So the channel has been a little less active, but when we are active, it again takes off. We just released a new song. So for Chloe, it's like whenever we release a new song, like a studio produced song, we also have her do like a stripped down acoustic version or ukulele version in her bedroom. And those do incredibly well. So we're always trying to hit you a couple different times with a song. Mm. And that works really well for us because her audience, I mean, they love her produced music, but the YouTube audience really wants to see her in her bedroom just like they did 2 years ago. So that's really important to us. And it's an incredible marketing tool because a week after we release the studio song, we get to hit you again with it. And the link is in the bio and she talks about it and all that stuff, you know? So it really helps us. And because she has such a wide audience and can talk before the video, she can also be like, I'm going on tour next month, or I have a new shirt up, or like, I'm doing this thing for charity, whatever it is. And it's incredibly beneficial for us.
I think you just hit on a thing, though, that is part of the YouTube thing that is so simple that people don't get, which is just the like, make a different version of the content.
Yeah, and just make it compelling. Like, you know, when we like the music videos we've released for Chloe so far, we did a first music video this past January and it blew up because she had never done a music video before. And it's really like, well, high quality. And it's like kind of like a gory, like spooky video. And so people were really into it. But then we did an acoustic version of it, and that crushed too. People want that, you know? And if you're going to, I mean, some of her audience, I'm sure, listens to her new song several times a day. They're definitely going to watch a different version of a YouTube video, you know, especially when you have a younger audience. And that's more of the artists that we're working with right now. I just, you don't know this yet either, I guess. It's very new. I've been working with a new artist named Addison Grace. Kind of like Robin, definitely wants to be a music artist, but is really popular on a platform. She has 2 million TikTok followers.
Oh, wow.
But she wants to be an artist, and she's a really talented songwriter, has an incredible voice. And so we were in this quandary of starting to work with her. She had nothing on YouTube, nothing on DSPs, nothing recorded, but she like has these songs that she plays on TikTok and stuff. You know, so I thought back to what we were doing with Chloe and Robin at the beginning, and I said, okay, let's not rush music onto DSPs. Let's take our time. Instead, you had a YouTube channel that you haven't published to in 2 years. Let's start releasing every Monday, one original song, then one cover song, then one original song, then one cover song. And she went from having 10,000 subscribers a month ago to close to 50,000 now in just a month.
Wow.
Her first song that we put up has over 100,000 streams in a month on YouTube. She put a Billie Eilish cover up just 1 week ago, and it has, by the time this is out, 100,000 plays. So, you know, we're really trying to develop an audience there for her on YouTube so that people are really familiar with Addison Grace, the artist, not the TikTok person. And so by the time we release any songs on DSPs, which is hopefully going to be in the next 6 to 8 weeks, it's much more like, oh, hey, like, by the way, I have a new song out now on Spotify. Go check it out. Because now she'll have, hopefully by then, she'll have 75,000 YouTube subscribers. So we're really also trying to build things in a smart, slow way. We're never trying to rush with the artists we work with. We like to build foundation. I just strongly believe in building foundation.
So, but that is counterintuitive to what a lot of people think. What informed that belief?
I'm just here for the long run. Me working with Kevin Devine is like a great other swing of that example. Kevin's career is older than Chloe is years ago. Like, truly. I think Kevin's been a professional artist since he was 20 and he's in his early 40s.
Yeah, I think we're the same age.
Chloe is 17. That doesn't happen by accident. A lot of hard work goes on it. And we're always trying to build a little more every time, right? Even with Kevin, when I started managing him in 2016, he's still growing. He isn't done growing yet. And Kevin's been doing this for 20 years. It is always a marathon for me. And I think for our company, and that's why we've had success. It's just like, look, would I love like any artist I work with to go mega viral?
Yeah.
Sure. But most artists that do come back down just as fast. You know, it's the very few that sustain to long careers. That doesn't mean there aren't those that do, right? But most don't. And I am not interested in managing an artist that I don't believe in. And I'm just excited, you know, I just want to be a part of them to make money from them for 6 months. Like, I want to be working with Chloe when she's 30, not just when she's 19 or 15. And all the years of doing this, I still work with like a ton of the artists I started with on day one. A couple have broken up. A couple were just mutual decisions to stop working with each other. But like Knuckle Puck, Citizen, Real Friends, Movements, Kevin Devine, like these are all artists we at the company have been managing for almost 6 years now, which is a long time in this world.
Oh, and management. That's eternity. Yeah.
Yeah. We don't get, I mean, we've never been fired by an artist and we don't plan on that changing, you know? So yeah, we just want to grow. Like it doesn't do me any good, especially for say this young Addison that I'm working with, for us to release a song on Spotify too, for it to go well and then to have nothing else for 4 months, right? Like we need to have a plan. We need to have lots of stuff coming and we need to build a real audience with her over time.
Yeah.
And I don't think I would have gone this route if I hadn't been working with Robin and Chloe before, but this strategy is already working and I'm excited about it.
Yeah. I mean, I think the biggest thing I see working now that people just can't seem to accept is real is that it's consistent, sustained promotion, that it's got
to
be.
Yeah. It always has to be slow growth. It always, look, obviously lots of people do the other thing and they have success. It's mm-hmm. not like my model's the only model, but Cavetown touring for close to 2 years straight was like really exhausting, obviously. And it was exhausting for me too. It's exhausting for everyone.
Yeah.
But I viewed that as like a punk artist. Like that's what I told him. I said, I want you to know what it's like to play in a 250 cap room in Philly without a green room, where it's literally a chair closet of where the chairs are is the green room. So you get to see this. So maybe you never have to see it again, right? But like, I want you to see this. You know, he did his first two tours in a van. Then we went to 500 cap, then 700 cap, then 1500 cap, right? I wanted him to see every step, and I wanted his audience to also see every step, because I thought there would be a better connection for them with him if they were able to see him in a 300 cap room and then at Webster Hall and then hopefully at Terminal 5 next time. I want you to be a part of that story. And I'm concerned that if we just started at Webster Hall, some of those people wouldn't come along to Terminal 5. You know, I want them to be invested in the artist just like I am.
Yeah, I think there is that thing that it is true that fans tell themselves a story about an artist. And when you have a story that begins to go shitty, it can be really detrimental to artists, and it's really hard to get around.
Yeah, it's hard to turn that back, you know, especially when you're going really fast. It's hard to it's hard to turn that back around and get to back to where you need to be. Yeah, YouTube has been interesting. It's tough. I wish I was I'm not a great social media person, people. I think sometimes people think I'm good at social media. I'm good at working with artists that are good at it, I think.
Well, yeah, filling in the blank.
Yeah, I don't use TikTok. I don't Grace spends 2 hours on TikTok a day.
Wow. You know?
She is hooked on TikTok. China loves Grace.
I
only use TikTok to look at her profile. You know, that's it.
And you're not seeing things from the algorithm that make you interested in keeping watching.
No. But, and I'm also not interested in, I mean, so many people, I'm sure you know, TikTok is the new, you only, record labels are only signing artists that are popular on TikTok.
Yeah.
And that's just not my thing. Chloe and Robin's record labels, respective labels, are not pleased that they don't use TikTok. And I have to tell them once a quarter, they are not using TikTok. You can't make us, you know, because they don't want to. Last thing I want is for them to use that profile because they're being forced and then being bad, you know?
I always go back to that thing with the younger artists of when Lorde started blowing up and her label, she tells the story. They're you got to use hashtags on Twitter. She's if I do that, my career's over. You guys do not get it. And she was right. And there is this thing that obviously we've both worked at large labels and have been around this, but there are a lot of people whose only brain cells tell them must imitate other things successful and don't get that there's lanes and separate things that all work for different artists. And not everything needs to be maximized by doing everything all the time. And you can have your own distinct personality and brand. And it's not about being an exception. It's actually about that, authenticity weighs more than anything else.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, trust me, the label definitely would rather Robin not be on TikTok than to make videos on why he thinks TikTok is dumb.
Am I missing anything? Is there any other way you would have done this? I need to know your questions and what no one else is telling you, since I want to answer them. So leave them in the comments, since I answer every comment in every post. I hope you liked this video, and if you did, please subscribe, and get notified. And I'm going to be breaking down the concepts in this video, along with how to promote your music and how to make songs you're happy with in the future. I have a Facebook group linked below that is only helpful information. No playlist or con artists, only artists having helpful discussions allowed. If you want to learn more about me, work on a record with me, or check out any of my books, podcasts, or anything else I do, go to jessecannon.com or at jessecannon on all the socials. One last thing, there's two playlists here. One is on how to grow your fan base from 0 to 10,000 fans, and the other is on how you promote your music with Spotify. Or you can hit the subscribe button below and stay tuned, as I have tons of tips for musicians.